Cecil's eyes narrowed, and he leaned forward so he could look Eddie in the face. "The difference is that assassins are in and out like a diamond-edged drill bit. They don't wind up on the front page of a newspaper because of a bloodbath that they were too fucking stupid to avoid." Eddie's hand moved instinctively toward the holster under his arm. He'd missed having the gun with him during his time on the plane and in the airports, but now it was a familiar weight in his grasp. As he pulled the gun out, he was already planning what he would say and how the skinny little bastard in the passenger seat would piss himself with fear. Those thoughts were cut short by the touch of warm steel against his throat. Eddie hadn't actually seen Cecil reach for the leather pouch in his pocket, but his brain put the pieces together after the fact. Unfortunately, the blade that had been inside that pouch was already out and pressing against the flesh just beneath his chin. Cecil's eyes hadn't wavered. His shoulders were in the same position, and the GPS was still clutched in his other hand. It seemed as though his left arm had come to life and taken action on its own, with the rest of Cecil's mind and body a mildly interested spectator. Squirming in his seat, Eddie barely realized that his foot had slipped off the gas pedal. Since the road was as straight as it was empty, there was plenty of room for the car to veer as it rolled to a gradual stop.
"You see that?" Cecil asked as he shifted the knife against Eddie's throat. "You're like a big kid strutting down a high school hallway. That makes you predictable and sloppy because you're too anxious to prove how tough you are."
"You want to kill me?" Eddie grunted as best he could without pushing himself against the blade in Cecil's hand. He couldn't see the weapon, but he could feel that the blade was only a few inches long and curved as if it had been custom-made for this very moment. "Then what are you waiting for? Do it. I bet you don't even have the stones to kill a man." The shift in Cecil's face was all but imperceptible.
"There's no way you could possibly believe that."
"What about the job?" Eddie asked, still confused by the fact that he was still alive. "Who's going to finish the job?" Glancing around the car as though he was looking for someone, Cecil said,
"We do the job, of course. Who do you think?"
"I mean, after what you said, are we still working together?"
"You got talent," Cecil announced. "I've seen plenty who started a shootout like the one in that hotel, but not many who would have been able to walk out in one piece. All you need to do is know where your strength lies and behave accordingly."
More to himself, he added,
"The rest is just a matter of putting you on the right job."
Enough time had passed for Eddie to pull himself together and get his mind back on track. He even felt a pinch of anger biting into his stomach as he gunned the rental car's engine and skidded onto the road. The next few seconds dragged by with Eddie at the wheel and Cecil calmly studying the GPS. If someone had looked away for the last few minutes, they might have thought nothing had happened between the time just before the rental car had turned off the main highway and now. But Eddie knew better. Plenty had changed. Eddie's life had been flipped like a quarter off of somebody's thumb. Whether he'd flipped toward a fat promotion within the Greek's organization or toward the end of his road, he couldn't quite say, not just yet, anyway.
"The turn's ahead about 2.5 miles,
Cecil said with less enthusiasm in his voice than the fat redhead from whom they'd rented the car.
"There's a grocery store at the turn. Pull in there so we can get some supplies.
Supplies? What supplies?